Welcome to the Archaeology Studio. Today's episode looks at rock art in archaeology. By the end of this episode, you will be prepared to describe what rock art is and discuss how it can be studied in archaeology. You can consider the unique challenges and the potential insights of studying ancient rock art. The simplest definition of rock art involves any artificial marking placed on a surface of natural stone. This general purpose definition can accommodate different kinds of rock art. The surface of a natural stone could be any kind of geological formation, and the artificial marking could occur in many different forms and styles. The specific kind of stone surface often is in or around a cave, and therefore rock art tends to be synonymous with cave art. In many cases, the environmental qualities inside caves happen to be beneficial for preserving rock art to a greater extent than might occur in an exposed exterior setting. Additionally, the ritual contexts in caves tend to coincide with the kinds of places where rock art would be most suitable. In cave settings, the specific location of rock art can be informative about the original context or purpose. For instance, people likely engaged in different kinds of activities at the exterior versus the interior of a cave. More distinctions can be ascertained among the natural light zones, semi-lighted or twilight zones, and dark zones of caves. Whether in a cave or in an outdoor setting, rock art most often is applied on a wall or a wall-like surface that is most easily visible in an ordinary viewing stance. Other instances are in difficult or unexpected positions, sometimes on a ceiling or on a floor. Most instances of rock art are surface visible. In extremely rare cases, rock art has been covered by sedimentary layers. In those rare cases, the dating of a sedimentary layer can provide a relative age in comparison with the rock art itself. Following the same logic, the thin accumulations of soot, hard water drips, or other minute traces potentially can be dated for supplying a relative age reference. These kinds of dating results, by their nature, can be vague. In cases of rock art made with pigments, potentially the raw material can be examined to identify if it contains organics suitable for radiocarbon dating, or other material suitable for different dating techniques. These approaches all would require an initial step of destructive analysis to identify the raw materials, followed by the actual dating procedure itself. The destructive component could be extremely minimal, but it needs to be recognized and considered before proceeding in any case. Most often, rock art can be dated by the age range of archaeological deposits in juxtaposed positions. For example, if a site area is known to date within a certain time range, then the associated rock art most likely belongs to the same time range. These results may not be as precise or as definitive as might be desired, but they always are instructive. Regarding the forms and styles of rock art, at least three major categories can be distinguished. First, petroglyphs refer to etched or engraved markings. Second, pictographs refer to drawn images. Third, rare cases of relief carvings refer to images sculpted in natural geological formations. Petroglyphs most often were created through percussive action or pecking, sometimes modified with further abrasion. The physical shapes of indentations can reveal the shapes of the tools that made them, but often the markings have been modified through repeated percussion and abrasion. Nonetheless, differences can be noted in the physical dimensions of width and depth of petroglyph markings. Next, petroglyph images could be described in terms of their overall size, numbers of internal components, use of straight and curved lines, use of symmetry, and other observations. In many parts of the world, petroglyph motifs include human figures, animals, and arrangements of circles or lines. Typically, some motifs defy easy identification, and they tend to be categorized as geometric shapes or unknown shapes. Many of the issues for describing petroglyphs could apply for pictographs. As drawn images, however, pictographs naturally involve a number of unique characteristics. First, the raw material of a pictograph can be described. The most obvious characteristic would be the color. Most of the world's pictographs are found in varieties of white, black, and shades of red or yellow. White color usually indicates calcium carbonate, such as from slaked lime. Black color usually signifies charcoal or soot. Red or yellow coloring tends to be due to the use of hematite or ochre, sometimes as one ingredient in a more complex recipe. In all cases, however, some kind of binding agent likely was involved for ensuring that the pigment could adhere to the natural rock surface. At most sites, the color of a pictograph likely has changed through time. For example, the vibrancy may have diminished or faded. In principle, the hue or chroma may have been altered, especially if organic binders have deteriorated through time. Next, pictographs can be described in their line width, thickness, and shapes. As seen with petroglyphs, many pictographs all around the world depict human figures. In many regions, hand stencils or hand prints are popular. Other images show animals, collections of dots, and of course, many shapes that are not immediately identifiable today. Relief images are rare in large, immovable natural geological formations, and they tend to be found in historical contexts with access to metal technologies and grand scales of labor. Most often, these kinds of rock art sites can be studied as monumental creations. When studying any rock art site, the individual motifs can be distinguished in categories of their physical properties, their positions, and their motifs. Whenever those characteristics show some kind of correlation, then the patterns in the evidence could suggest something about the original cultural concepts or intended use of the different rock art components. For example, at the Rutidian site in Guam, I found that white pigment figures tended to occur in the light or twilight zones of caves, at shoulder height or within an arm's reach upward, and typically at caves where the archaeological deposits dated within a range of AD 1000 through 1700. They sometimes occurred at sites with multiple sedimentary layers of older ages, as old as 1500 BC, but then the white pigment figures had been drawn superimposed over older pre-existing red pigment handprints. I then examined the different pictograph colors, positions, and motifs in comparison with the associated age ranges in the site deposits, and I could propose a possible relative chronology. Nonetheless, the rock art here has not yet been dated directly in its raw materials, so the proposed chronology must be regarded as tentative and pending further confirmation. Given the ritual associations of most rock art sites, the context is crucial for interpreting each motif or component. Now, with digital recording technologies, these sites can be documented in great detail. As a bonus, this approach allows a permanent record of the site that can be accessed remotely and in perpetuity without actually visiting the site and risking inadvertent damage in these often delicate environments. Rock art often is enigmatic, but you can begin to study any instance of rock art in terms of its objective physical attributes. Next, you can build your sets of observations, and you can identify correlations or differences in the patterns of evidence. The more clearly that you can describe the physical attributes, the more confidently you can develop your interpretations. Logically, the interpretations should be consistent with the physical data observations. In concluding this episode, now you should be familiar with rock art in archaeology. Whenever you encounter rock art at an archaeological site or see the results of a study in a publication or a museum exhibit, then you should be aware of the issues involved in technical observation and logical interpretation. If you liked this video, then I encourage you to explore the online content archive, subscribe to this YouTube channel, and see new episodes every month with the Archaeology Studios.